Can powerful ice flows and 200-meter tall wind turbines live in harmony? I'm heading into the world's largest indoor ice basin to find out what one international team is doing to find out and bring clean energy into more homes. Aalto Ice Tank is one of the only places on Earth where researchers can customize huge slabs of ice and test how they interact with human-made structures.
What we're testing is how a real wind turbine would interact with ice coming in at different speeds. This hasn't been done before in this way.
That's Hayo, who's part of the international team interested in the tiny or large shakes that occur when ice and structures collide. In the real world, ice-induced vibration may be small at the waterline, but all the way up at the top of a wind turbine, the blades can move meters. To test out different scenarios and see what really happens, the team is doing what's called hybrid testing, where they combine numerical modeling with physical experiments. But first, they need to take a close look at the ice to make sure they know exactly how strong it is and how it breaks.
What's special for this kind of test is that we test at these very cold temperatures. Normally, you have the temperature around zero, and we test at minus 11 now to make sure the ice is strong and breaks in a more realistic way.
Once they know what they're getting into, the team drags the model pile through the huge sheet of ice to mimic how ice would hit the turbine, either at constant or variable speeds. Translated into real-life terms, the load exerted from the ice would be around 8 meganewtons. That's the thrust of not just one or two, but 16 of the largest aircraft engines combined.
And we have to somehow make sure we can model the wind loading at the top of the structure. So we use two electric arms to control the structure and to impose that wind loading.
In the great outdoors, ice can form, break, melt, and refreeze many times over a season to create uneven formations. Weather patterns change from one year to another. Add the realities of a warming climate, and predicting how tons of frozen H2 will behave is tricky business.
The ice behaves very differently depending a little bit on the type of the structure that it's interacting with. It behaves a little bit differently depending on the, let's say, the speed of interaction, how fast the ice is moving. So we have a basic understanding of these mechanisms and so on, but what we don't exactly know is that how large are the loads that ice can cause to an offshore structure. We would need to be able to design offshore structures, ships, lighthouses, bridge piers in a way that they can withstand these loads. What we end up doing is that we build them overly conservative at the moment. What that then means, of course, that those structures are not going to be efficient. We waste a lot of material, a lot of resources.
That overly conservative approach is also expensive, which is one reason why offshore wind farms are largely in waters that don't enter deep freezes. To get these huge structures into chillier waters, we need better design. And that starts with understanding the fundamentals of what happens when turbines meet ice.
Most offshore wind turbines are now located in locations like the North Sea. What we want to do is use as the least amount of steel as possible and go into regions that we now cannot go into because there's too much ice and the ice is too thick and too strong. But when we design these turbines, we need to take into account anything that can happen, and we calculate for the most extreme case in 50 years.
The hard work has paid off. The team's experiments at Ice Tank are showing something totally new.
We found that for this particular structure, something is happening which we haven't seen before. And our experience comes from lighthouses, channel markers, oil and gas platforms. And now we're testing a really different structure. The turbine is very tall, very slender, can move a lot. And we saw what I would call a new type of vibrations.
Gathering data like this isn't just cool. It'll help create more robust models to test all kinds of scenarios and ultimately design more efficient, sustainable offshore wind farms.
The models are very good in giving us very detailed information on what is happening in sea ice when it's colliding with the structure. Even in this lab environment, we get to do fairly detailed observations, but we cannot see all that is happening. But what you can do with a numerical model is that you can really go into a lot of detail on what is happening. You can follow ice fragment in your simulation and see where it's going, what kind of loads is it applying to somewhere, what kind of loads are applied on it.
Do you see that there's increased need for this work when we think about the kind of extreme weather events happening around the world now?
I do think, yeah. One of the non-intuitive things maybe is that we know that unfortunately sea ice is in decline, has been for a while already because of the climate change and global warming. But on the same time, we are seeing more and more human activities on ice-covered seas.